2016. Okay. Okay, next, please. We want to welcome everybody to worship today. Everyone who's attending for the first time here and or online, we'd like to give everybody a big round of applause, an encouragement today. We welcome you. Okay, next, please. And the two-year Sanctuary Church anniversary is coming up soon. Lunch will not be served at Sanctuary on May 29th. Okay? No potluck at the church on May 29th. On when is that? May 29th. Okay. All right. The youth ministry will fundraise at the park with hot dogs, takoyaki. Who knows what that is? Okay, it's Japanese street food, okay? And other delicious items. Healthy desserts will be welcome. Programs will be performances, SOS and others. Sports, praise painting, competition, face painting, etc. So be sure to join us on May 29th for that, those events. And that is, if you want more information, please talk to Andy, and he will have all the information for you. Okay, next, please. Sanctuary Summer Family Camp, that's from June 26th to July 3rd, Camp Daddy Allen, PA. We'll have lots of family fun. Online registration is now available. Christ-centered, Bible-focused, praise and worship, education for all ages. Early bird pricing ends May 15th. Is Greg coming up for a second? Okay. Early bird pricing ends May 15th, so quick sign up, okay, for the camp. Now, a lot of this will be also apologetics and things like this, so it's very Bible-centered, so we have a clear way that we can know how to decipher the world. The difference between good and evil. Amen? Next, please. Freedom Society Seminars, April 28th, we discuss the topic, Evil is Real. Join us for our next meeting on Thursday, May 12th. Location is at the Car Arms Conference Room, Lawrence Valley, PA, 7 p.m. And that is next week, is that correct?
Yes.
Not April 28th, is it? That was April. May 12th. This is this week. Our next meeting is this week.
Yes.
Okay, Thursday. We were actually hoping that it was last week. We were all waiting on Thursday. Oh, it's not, no Freedom Society today. Such a great way to understand freedom, understand the root of freedom, understand the nature of freedom, the nature of the world. Next, please. Divine Principle Seminars, dates will be every third Saturday of every month, starting May 21st. Every third Saturday of every month, starting May 21st. Okay? The time will be 8:30 a.m., registration 9 a.m., opening, and 5 p.m. closing, so it will be a day lecture, and the lectures include William Brunhofer, James Ward, Dr. Richard Panzer, Brian Sabrin, and the location will be Small Sanctuary. Please contact Lourdes for details. Is that correct? Okay, Lourdes. Okay, next, please. And we had a wonderful competition in the youth group of the teens, teen youth group of different apologetics. And I believe there was a prize. Was there a prize? Okay, and there were judges and everything, and they voted. What was the prize?
$100.
$100 prize. And so today we will have a presentation, a re-presentation of the first prize winner of the apologist prize. Let's give it a one time for Shimman. He won first prize.
Hello. So yesterday, we had a apologetics competition, and it was basically a free speech that you could choose in four topics. You can either talk about God, I mean Jesus, or true father, or the existence of God, or you can talk about media. I chose the existence of God, and I was lucky enough to win. And it was actually, I didn't know that this was happening, and I just came in, and my mom told me it's happening. And I was a bit surprised, but I thought it was a joke. Okay. So today, I think I'll just say the same thing as I said yesterday. Okay. Okay. So today, I want to talk about one macrocosmic level and one microcosmic level of why I think God exists. But before we do that, I want to tell you a little story a man had with God. So the man asked God, God, what's a million years to you? And God said, a second. And man said, oh, then what's $1 million to you? And God said, a penny. He said, oh, then can I have $1 million? And he said, sure, in a second. Okay, moving on, we're going to be first looking at the macrocosmic level. It is almost universally accepted in the world of science that the Big Bang created the universe. The Big Bang is when, in a certain period of time and space, pre-existing matter exploded, that pre-existing matter became more dense, and that created the universe. But that begs a question, where'd that come from? To truly understand this, it is important to understand that the Big Bang was not an explosion in space, but the explosion of space, not the explosion in a certain period of time, but the beginning of time, not the explosion of pre-existing matter, but the creation of matter itself. So whatever created the universe has to be beyond space, beyond time, beyond matter, something spaceless, timeless, and immaterial. And ladies and gentlemen, that's exactly what God is. He's omnipotent, omniscient, and omnipresent. But the most fascinating thing about this is that Jews and Christians have always believed that God has created the universe, let alone out of nothingness. In the Bible, it quotes, in the beginning, there was the Word. The Bible implies God has literally spoken the universe into existence. Do you see how mind-blowing this is? For thousands and decades, the Bible was correct. Okay. Now that we looked at the macrocosmic level, let's look at the microcosmic level. And for that, we're going to be looking at DNA. DNA is a fascinating yet complex structure made out of multiple amount of cells that is the blueprint of all living things, including you and me. And just to give you an example, the amount of information that can be stored in a pinhead's volume of DNA is equivalent to 5 times of paperback books from the distance from Earth to the moon. And one strand of DNA, this tiny thing that you can't even see, that you have to, oh, you can only see this with a high-powered microscope, contains the information that can create 30,000 paperback books. Once again, this begs the question, where'd this come from? In the world of science, one of the core laws in the world of science is that information cannot be created by matter by itself. It has to have an intellect. When you trace that information, it has to have a source. And, well, in my opinion, I think one strand of DNA that can create 30,000 stacks of paperback books is quite a lot of information. So simply, to put this simply, DNA is pointing that God exists because DNA is a creative information. Therefore, it has to have a creative intellect, which is God. And, well, there's this theory called Darwin's evolutionary theory. But you have to understand, in Darwin's period of time, scientists did not have the right tools nor the information to see what was inside the cell. In fact, when Darwin first saw the cell, he thought it was very elementary, that by few instructions you can create another copy of it. And Darwin actually quoted in one of his words that if the first life form on Earth was more complex than his theory, then his whole theory of evolution would be incorrect. And all these facts are one of just many facts that God exists. And I truly believe that by learning these types of facts, and such as apologetics, is very important because It can bring people such as you and me and other people closer to God's community. Thank you very much.
Good job. Not bad, not bad. Not bad. Okay, so that was the, they had a wonderful competition yesterday, training and thinking, at least thinking about these issues, right? Not thinking about apologetics, thinking. Because as soon as you can start to use your mind to think about God, all things start pointing, you know, in the right direction. Amen. So that's, we're very happy about the young people doing that. Next, please. Today we have HSU announcements. We want to give a big thanks to our spring HSU class leaders. Let's call Carrie Williams, who's our organizer for HSU, to give us a little more on this. Let's give her a big round of applause.
Good morning. How's everybody today? Wasn't that a great speech by Shinman? Okay, so we have now come to the end of our spring term of HSU. Could I ask everybody who led a class this past trimester to please stand? Let's have an applause for every person who is standing at this time. Please remain standing as I introduce you. These guys did a great job leading classes of around 100 people total from all over the world. We had class members in Europe, in Africa, in Korea, and all over the United States. First we had Brother Lowell Ellenson, who was his able assistant to Lisa, who actually led the class on Right to Life, Firearms Under God's Authority. I was a member of that class. It was fantastic. Thank you, Lowell and Lisa. Or Lisa and Lowell, I should say. And our prayers and loves go to Lisa and her recuperation. Next, we had Dr. Richard Panzer, who led the economics of Chung-il-guk, about prosperity in God's kingdom. Thank you, Richard, for that wonderful class. We had preparedness piece by Arthur Noren, who really helped many people prepare for hope for the prepare for the hope for the best and prepare for the worst, and he was helping us prepare for the worst. Thank you, Brother Arthur. The First Lady of our church, Yananim, whose class title is a bit of a misnomer. It says, "I know nothing about the Bible." Actually, she knows quite a bit about the Bible, but she's very humble, and she led it in for the second time. The first time was in English, this time in Korea, and because of her work, actually, the Korean HSU Providence is now beginning. Thank you, Yananim, for your wonderful work. And Jim Stevens, Jim and Hiromi Stevens, who are actually in, they were going to be here, but they had to go to California because they're expecting their first grandchild. So I guess that was more important than being here. They led a wonderful class on God's design for men, women, and sexuality, which was a wonderful class. My husband took it and learned a lot. And I believe last but not least, we have Greg and Elka Knoll, shining with health in the back, actually, I had dinner at the Brunhofer's house, and I had this incredible bean dip. And they said, "Oh, we learned how to make that at Greg and Elka's class." Their class was the Maker's Diet Kickstart Your Health, and they did a wonderful job and helped a lot of people. So one more round of applause for everybody. Thank you so much, brothers and sisters. And have a seat. And now we have a little video for you of this past trimester's HSU.
Raindrops rolling kindergarten class, especially we learn how to really awareness in our society, especially how to use and to know safety about the gun and our motivation to protect our family and our brother sister and our community. Building my kingdom just to watch
it fade away. And that was a pretty exciting class, and I think only blessed couples should take that. It's very exciting, interesting, and I love it. Any comment?
I love it.
Amen.
I am very proud of this class because I can use it for my daily life with my husband, relationship. Actually, 100% I'm learning, and then I try, but still far away. I feel so far away, but I'm so glad to attend this class.
It really is focusing on father's insights about the man-woman relationship, and then connecting that with science. And it's a wonderful class. It really is. It's kind of helping me to kind of look at my own relationship in my marriage, and to pay attention to certain issues and to be hopefully a better husband and also a better father.
It's made quite a difference in relating to my wife in a way that is more accurate to who she actually is. One of the things that they emphasized early on was the enormous differences between men's and women's brains, the way they think and the way they react to things. There are actually many, many physical differences between men's and women's brains that cause them to act in a way that just is entirely different. The two sexes are different. It's not negotiable. So I realize my wife's not broken. She's not crazy. She's a woman. So now I can relate to that, and it makes life a lot easier. I need to stay. I'll be chasing every breeze that blows my way. I'll be building my kingdom just to watch it fade away. It's true that I'd be packing my bag when I need to stay. I'll be chasing every breeze. 성경을 제대로 공부하면서 성경이 정말 위대한 책이고 거기에 하나님이 임하신다는 것을 느끼고 있습니다. 그리고 성경을 통해서 하나님의 말씀과 행하심을 보고 또 읽고 같이 토론을 하면서 하나님의 관점을 찾아가는 그런 정말 뜻깊은 시간이었습니다.
It was about the book and more. It's great to need to understand Jesus to understand our situation today. Amen. Great class. I encourage everybody. Thank you.
It's been a real wonderful experience for me. One day I was driving to work and I felt that Jesus made me feel that he really wants me to get to know him better. And to me it was an amazing feeling. And from there on, reading the Bible and sharing with brothers and sisters from different countries as well, it's been a real amazing experience. I feel like I've been learning a lot more and understanding a lot more, and I have a lot more to learn too. But this was a very good beginning. I encourage everyone to try something through this class. When I sit back and imagine life without you, I can't fathom how I ever thought I'd make it on my own.
And there's at least a million reasons to stand. I attended the Kickstart Your Health HSU class. And what we focused on is how to eat to live. And it was very interesting because we had to question ourselves on many things, the way we eat ourselves. And we watch movies, and we had a demonstration of a special recipe. And to change from an animal diet to a plant-based diet. And this was very helpful.
I really had a great time at the sanctuary class with, actually HSU class, with Kerry Williams. We studied More Than a Carpenter, and the things that came out, the things that actually making new friends from all over the world, I felt very close to you get, Dominic, and, you know, people from all everywhere were there, and it just made the world seem a lot closer and smaller, and the friendship and camaraderie that happened just online was something I didn't imagine could happen. So next time, if I ever have a class, I want to do it online too. And you'll learn a lot, and you'll share a lot, and it's fun. So please join our classes. It's a great experience. Now I know.
Wow. Thanks to Shina Moon, who made that awesome video. Thank you, Shina. Whew. Isn't that awesome? Yeah. So actually, I also led a class. I guess you got that from the video. I forgot. More Than a Carpenter, which was really, really wonderful. And also, I just want to say that I really didn't want to lead an online class. That's what it turned out to be. And it was a great experience, like Tammy shared. I feel close friends now with brothers and sisters from Italy and Nigeria and New Jersey. It's amazing. it really does make the world a smaller place. I don't want to take any more of your time, just to say that everyone who took the class and successfully completed it will be getting a certificate prepared by the able-bodied Jim Bohr. He's going to prepare those certificates and get them to us. And also, next Sunday, hold on to your hats, because sign-ups are going to begin for the summer trimester. So stay tuned. Thank you very much.
Amen. Thank you, Carrie. Wow, wasn't that video amazing? Did you see that? That was incredible. Let's give it a one time for Shina. Whoa, she got some skills. That was insane. Okay, everyone is welcome to lunch. We thank you all for your wonderful potluck dishes and respecting adults for the kids at lunch, letting the adults go first. Please do not take food into the small chapel or library. The food ministry team appreciates your help in bringing healthy desserts. Healthy, folks. Healthy desserts. They're asking to bring healthy desserts, okay? For everyone, and creating an enjoyable lunchtime for everyone. Let's give it a one time for our food ministry team, who's joining us via teleprompter. Okay, and join us for lunch after service. Next, please. Reminder, the parents of infants 48 months and below, please use the nursery room or remain in the main service with your child. Thank you very much, and Sunday school will be beginning in about 1 minute. Hold on 1 second. Okay, so we thank you for your parents. The parents remembering to, if you have 48 months or below, please use nursery room or remain in the main service with your child. Next, please. Surprise from mothers. It's Mother's Day. All right. Come on down, kids. What do you got? What's your surprise? All right. Ambush your moms. Ambush your moms. Okay. Don't dump that water on her now. No, Chico won again. We're done after announcement. Yeah. Okay, give it to your mom. Okay. So remember, your moms are doing something very difficult. They're standing for father being persecuted. So you don't have normal moms. You have heroic moms who are brides of Christ and stand with God. Amen. Let's give it a one time for our moms here and all the brides of Christ worldwide. Next, please. And on a very sad note, folks, the family fraud has started legal action against us. So they have taken now a formal legal action. We received a cease and desist notice on Friday, was it? So they are of course, aggressively now trying to come after us. Okay? We're just a small community in the countryside trying to learn organic farming and aquaponics, be empowered by Freedom Society, raise our kids in freedom and responsibility. And of course, the, big aggressors. And again, I thought they vowed never to do lawsuits again. But I guess they want to waste their members' money to do more lawsuits. So about this issue, I'd like to ask Richard to come up and share some words on this. Let's give Richard a big round of applause.
Could you use a clicker?
Thank you. Okay, so I don't like to read, but I'm gonna have to read, but I have some slides, so please look at the slides and not at me reading, okay? Okay, so if we could put up the first. Okay, I'd like to start out by reading from Matthew 21. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to each other, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and take his inheritance." So they took him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. Therefore, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? And then Jesus' disciples said, "He will bring those wretches to a wretched end, and he will rent the vineyard to other tenants who will give him his share of the crop at harvest time." And Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and the Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes'?" So, as Hyunjin mentioned, on May 4th, Michael Balcom and Ki-hoon Kim released a letter indicating the intention of the Family Federation to take legal action to protect their property. The unification symbol designed by Father and the term Chunalguk from being used by an organization that actually values and believes in Father's words, the Unification Sanctuary. To us, that symbol and Father's teaching is not property. It is Father's precious blood. That's how we view Father's words and the symbol that Father developed. Now, following Mother's direction, the unification symbol is not being used anywhere in the world by HSA-UWC or its affiliates. The Family Federation position regarding the unification symbol is, we won't use it, but we don't want anyone else to use it either. That is very sad. So this legal action is in line with the Family Federation apparent new philosophy, which is, you know, their motto is forgive, love, unite. So I realized their new motto should be forgive, love, sue, and bully, because that is what they're doing. That is what they're doing. And we really have to look at the difference between the rhetoric of the Family Federation and their actions. There's quite a difference. It is truly sad that the precious donations of brothers and sisters around the world are being used for pointless legal actions to prevent those who love Father from using the symbol that represents the 12 gates to heaven that Father opened up with his blood, sweat, and tears. So I'm going to wear my symbol actually every day from now on. They can sue me. Here I am. So actually, I was thinking on the plus side, you know, the silver lining is that at least the Family Federation is consistent. It's consistent in its focus to erase both the symbol and substance of Father's words and to replace them with its unprincipled, sinless, only begotten daughter, hand mother theology. So the choice is becoming more and more clear. So I just want to say to Family Federation, thank you. Thank you for revealing where your heart really is. Thank you for showing the whole, all brothers and sisters, what you really care about. Now, I want to switch quickly to another issue, because it's like an onion. You peel off layers and you get deeper and deeper into where is their thought really going. So, yeah. So I received the following email 2 days ago regarding the Family Federation's embrace and sponsorship of Andrew Wilson's presentations in Korea, Europe, and here in America. I'd like to read the email that I got. Dear Richard, I am surprised that no one ever mentions that Andy Wilson is a longtime leader of a secretive, highly controversial cult that revolves around the channeling activities of Chris Kraft. Andy has been a worshiper of the Mother God through the channeling of Chris Kraft long before the rising of Sanctuary. This group has several active and devoted followers. It was central to Yejinim's world until Yejin had a falling out with Kraft and rejected him in favor of an American-based channeler. Through Yejin, though Yejin rejected Kraft, the cult that continues to surround him did not and remains active. Andy is a core leader of this secretive group. It also is curious that the official UC gives such prominence to a person following an odd secretive schism involving a small number of UC members. Now, in 2013, I stopped reading, okay, so this is just me talking. In 2013, I attended an ontology conference at UTS that Andrew helped to organize, where Chris Kraft, this brother that was mentioned before, who channels Mother God, he spoke there. And in one session, Chris Kraft, AKA Mother God, said that since this is the age of women, that the next president would and should be Hillary Clinton. So after the conference, I was thinking about this. So I sent an email to Chris Kraft, and I asked Chris, can you ask Mother God the following question? Why couldn't a conservative woman who actually believes and supports the Four Position Foundation be elected president? I mean, I would love to see a woman president, but not just because she has a uterus. I want to vote for somebody who actually believes in the principles in the Four Position Foundation. Yeah. Right? Yeah. I would love to see a woman president, but not just any woman. And then the answer I got back was very revealing. Chris Kraft emailed the following response from, quote, Mother God. Quote, I am not in contact with that part of the spirit world. So I realize it seems that Mother God is only in contact with the liberal, progressive, left-wing part of the spirit world that endorses... gay marriage and sexual rights, etc. And I'm sure that she's rooting right now for Hillary at this very moment. So Andrew has spoken publicly of his support at various church functions, of his support for Hillary Clinton. Since I believe in freedom of conscience, I believe Andrew has the right to vote for whomever he wishes. But it is surprising to me that he would vocally support a candidate and a political party that seems hell-bent on destroying the Four Position Foundation by endorsing gay marriage, sexual rights indoctrination on the entire US population and indeed the entire world. At the United Nations, Hillary Clinton's State Department and the Obama's ambassador repeatedly threatened African and Caribbean countries with cutting off all US aid if they did not support the gay and sexual rights agenda. This, which asserts that women have a right to engage in prostitution, that young people have an absolute right to be sexually active or to use pornography at any age, and that programs encouraging them to wait are a violation of their human rights. Our government funds are being used to spread education, which actually leads to millions of deaths. Okay, I just want to show quickly. On the right, there was one country in Africa that was able to cut their HIV infection rate from 15% of their national population was infected with the AIDS virus in 1990. They were able to cut it down to 5% in a 15-year period. And how did they do this? They basically taught young people. They said, young people, if you've never had sex yet, then wait. Abstain from sex until you're older, ideally till you get married. And then, so it's ABC. That's the A's for abstain. And the B part of their message was, if you're already sexually active, then be faithful to one person. Be faithful to the person that you love. That was the B part of their message. And then this small C was, well, if you're too stupid to do A or B, then at least do C. You know, if you're a prostitute or you're a truck driver driving around all over the place and you can't control your sexual desire, then use a condom. That was A, B, C. That message saved millions of lives in Uganda, and it was working. So what did the United Nations and USAID and very powerful Western organizations do? They came in with Western-style sexual rights education, so-called safe sex education, which is not safe, and they brought it to Botswana, which is a much richer country than Uganda, actually, and they carpet bombed the whole country with condoms. There are condoms all over Botswana, all over the place, and they educated people. Don't worry about being faithful or waiting. Just use condoms. That'll solve your problem. And in 1990, 3% of their population was HIV infected. That increased to 10% in 1992. And 2011, 24% of their national population is infected with the AIDS virus. So you can see that Western-style education, cultural imperialism, has led to millions of deaths in Africa and other parts of the world. And this is a kind of education that Hillary Clinton and our government, State Department, and the United Nations is promoting all over the world. So I think, you know, this is Mother's Day. We really have to think deeply about what we want our country to stand for. I used to believe that America was a force for good in the world, and I believe that the majority of the American population believes in God-centered values that we share. But our government does not represent these basic values. And that's one of the reasons that Father came to America, because Father knew that there were evil forces in this country that want to hijack our government to basically spread their satanic education throughout the world using the power of the American government. You know, Hyung has warned us that there's an alliance. When there's an alliance between a corrupt religious hierarchy and the government and other powerful, you know, big business and so on, it's not a good result. So I just hope, to me, it is sad for the Family Federation to persecute the son that Father anointed. But they're not just persecuting Hyunjinim, they're persecuting Father's teachings. And they are getting in bed with people who do not agree with the teachings that Father gave his life for, actually. You know, we really have to think, people have to think much more deeply. It's not just who promises you more free stuff. You have to look at what people stand for and what they believe and really pray about what kind of country you want your children and your grandchildren to live in. So, thank you.
Thank you, Richard. Yeah, so it's very sad. that they're, you know, aggressively now taking legal action, even though they've promised their own members that they would never take legal action again. They want peace and family fed for world peace and unification, and let's sue and bully, you know. And they want to talk about property. I mean, I am the inheritor of Father, right? I am Father himself crowned me 3 times in front of the whole world. You want to talk about property? That mark is my property. That's not their property. The scriptures are my property. All the whole foundation of church, that's my property. That's not their property. It was given to me. So they're such fools that they're even trying to go that way. And of course, not only threatening, but now taking legal action. It shows you where they're at, right? So as sanctuaries worldwide, we're coming into the blessing of freedom and responsibility, being with people who are truly, you know, entrepreneurs, producers, brave, who are not slaves to the archangels and the Korean leadership, and people who truly love Father and are not bought off and paid for as prostitutes to, you know, a couple, you know, a measly, stupid salaries, right? And as this movement has been growing, and then all the wonderful things that are happening with Holy Spirit University and the developments that are happening worldwide, of course, they see and they want to, obviously, they want to get rid of that, destroy it, because why? They know they're illegitimate. They know they're fraudulent. They know they're fake. They know they're usurpers. In order to cover for themselves, they have to try to destroy what Father has already created. So it's very sad that now we have to go into this, and of course now we're going to have to talk to lawyers and take it from there. So this is, you know, where it rests. Let's go to the sermon today. And we were just going to do a study on this. We're just a small community minding our own business, speaking the truth to power, building our own systems of independence and interdependence, learning how to farm and do, you know, organic, you know, aquaponics, and learn how to eat right and you know, raise our kids empowered and strong, and, you know, learning self-defense and all those things. And here the big city slicker tyrants and totalitarians want to come try to wipe us out of existence. So ridiculous. It's so pitiful, it's so cowardly, it's so debased. It shows you the level of their fraudulence. Okay, well, let's go to kingdom dynamics today. Let's go back to this topic. That was another topic. Let's jump off that topic. And let's get back to our study, because we're studying the Word, okay? So if you got your Bible, we're going to Matthew 20 today. Matthew 20, let's open up to Matthew chapter 20. Okay, and I just want to remind you, before, you can keep it right at 20, but we mentioned many times, and these are just a reminder of those scriptures, that when Jesus talked about the gospel, he's not talking about the cross. This has been traditional Christian ideology for, you know, thousands of years. But when Jesus himself is talking about the gospel, he is not talking about the cross. You can see in Matthew 6, of course, he teaches everybody how to pray. They pray like this every day. Your kingdom come, basilia. Comes from the word basileus, which means king. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. He also says in Matthew 6:33, seek ye first, what? Not the cross. He said the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto him. Now, the cross was a redemptive path. We know that salvation comes through the cross. Spiritual salvation did come through the cross through, you know, history of Christianity. So we're not downplaying that. It has tremendous power in understanding God's grace, a tremendous power understanding God's love. However, it is not actually the gospel that Jesus was talking about. Okay? It says in Matthew 7, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. And he told the disciples in Matthew 10, go preach, saying the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Matthew 11. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. See how constantly he's talking about the kingdom, kingdom, kingdom. And as we move through the chapters, we see he's talking about kingdom all the time. And he said unto them, I must preach the kingdom of God to other cities also, for therefore am I sent. Jesus himself said, I am sent to preach the kingdom of God. He didn't say, I'm sent to die. He didn't say that. He didn't say, I'm sent to die. You can check it in your own Bible, Luke 4:43. Jesus never said, he never even talked about the crucifixion, his crucifixion in public. We'll see that today in Matthew 20. But he said, I must preach the kingdom of God in other cities also, for therefore am I sent. He says very clearly, I am sent for the purpose of teaching the kingdom, preaching the kingdom. Now, this is very, very shocking for most people who grow up in a Christian tradition, because many times we don't look at the word. We hear just what that denomination says, or what the Methodists say, or Episcopal say, or the Catholics say. We don't actually look at the word that Jesus spoke. He said himself, I am sent for the reason of preaching the kingdom. So, of course, this is totally in line with the divine principle, which we will have a class on every third Saturday. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. And Jesus went about Galilee teaching in synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing all manner of sickness, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Which gospel? The kingdom of God. It's right there in the Bible. I mean, it's right there in the Bible, but nobody is looking at the Bible and they're listening to the denominations. Right? Matthew 9, Jesus went in all the cities and villages preaching the gospel of the kingdom. Matthew 24, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Well, guess what? It's being preached. The kingdom is being preached. All right, so let's go to Matthew 20 today, and let's read this all together from verse 1. For the kingdom of heaven is like unto a man that is a householder, which went out early in the morning to hire laborers into his vineyard. And when he had agreed with the laborers for a penny a day, or a denarii a day, that's a day's wage, he sent them into his vineyard. And he went out about the third hour and saw others standing idle in the marketplace and said unto them, go ye also into the vineyard, and whatsoever is right I will give you. And they went their way. Again he went out about the sixth and ninth hour and did likewise. And about the 11th hour he went out and found others standing idle and saith unto them, why stand ye here all the day idle? They say unto him, because no man hath hired us. He said, go ye also into the vineyard, and whatsoever is right, that shall ye receive. So when evening was come, the Lord of the vineyard saith unto his steward, call the laborers, and give them their hire, beginning from the last unto the first. And when they came that were hired about the 11th hour, they received every man a penny, or a denarii, a day's labor, wage. But when the first came, they supposed that they should have received more. And they likewise received every man a penny. So everybody received a penny. And when they had received it, they murmured against the good man of the house, saying, these last have wrought but 1 hour, and thou hast made them equal unto us, which have borne the burden and the heat of the day. But he answered one of them and said, friend, I did nothing wrong. Didst thou not agree with me for a penny? Take that, thine is, and go thy way. I will give unto this last, even as unto thee. Is it not lawful for me to do what I will with my own? Is thine eye evil because I am good? So the last shall be first, and the first shall be last. Okay, let's go into this. Let's go into this. So you understand the context of Jesus saying, the kingdom of heaven is like this. Okay? And he's saying it's like this. It's like there's a householder, and he needs people to work his vineyard. Okay? So he goes out to the marketplace in the early morning. He gets a person, right? And he agrees with that laborer for a penny a day. A denarii a day means a day's wage for that day. Okay? Then he goes out again. So he needs more workers. So he goes out again. Third hour, he goes out again. like the sixth hour, the ninth hour. But look at this. He says when he goes out the third hour and then sixth and ninth, he goes to the people, the laborers, and he says, go into my vineyard, and whatsoever is right, I will give you. 11th hour, he goes out again. Sixth, ninth hour, 11th hour, he goes out again, and he says, whatsoever is right, that shall you receive. Okay? So he's saying, you guys go into the vineyard and work, and I will give you whatever you deserve. Notice that in the third, sixth, ninth, 11th hour, he doesn't actually even tell them, I'll give you a day's wage. He doesn't say, I'll remember the first guy, look at this, first guy, he agrees, there's a contract, he agrees, there's an agreement, I'll pay you a day's wage. The other guys, it's like, I may pay you nothing, I'll give you what you deserve. Right? But you just go and work, right? And then, so what happens? So now they're being paid. They're finally, the day is done, and they're to be paid. And what happens? The guy who was working all day long gets the day's wage, right? He gets a denarii. That's what they agreed upon. But then the householder gives the same denarii to everybody, including the guy who just worked 1 hour. So the first guy's like, hey, what's up with that, master, right? He said, why you do that? That's unfair. I did, and but look at what the master said. And he said, wait, friend, I did nothing wrong. You agreed with me to get a denarii, one penny. That's what we agreed on, right? I can do what I want to do with my money. Isn't that interesting? Now, let's look at this in the context. Now, okay, we're kind of emotionally on the topic of Family Fed taking legal action against us. Let's just forget about that for now, okay? Let's go into the study. This study is different from that topic, okay? Let's just like pretend that you didn't hear about that. We can talk about it later, whatever, but let's right here. So it's interesting because here, he agrees with the first guy, I'll give you a dollar. But look, the other guys, he never agreed on a price. In a national level, what is that? What in the marketplace, what is that? When somebody works for you, and there's really no set upon price, they're working maybe to earn knowledge of the industry, right? Maybe to earn experience of the industry, because what? The more knowledge you have of the industry, the higher you get paid. Lawyers get paid higher because they know more about legal issues. Accountants get paid higher because they know more, right? Knowledge, knowing about those industries is where you increase your marketability, right? Your economic marketability is what it's called, right? So here, what are we talking about here, really? We're talking about what? In Chunyugug, we're talking about interns. You see that? Interns. Interns, people who work in a particular company or whatever, in a job. But and many, how many started as an intern? Just helping out around the farm or helping around, you know, your parents' business. So many people start out like that, their career, right? Just by learning the skills of that trade. That makes sense? Yeah. They're not actually... expected even to be paid, right? They're learning valuable skills that will have pay off in the end. They will pay off. That work and that knowledge that they're learning on site with real people in that industry, with networks that are now developing in that industry, they're developing real assets in that industry. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And that's such a critical element in a free system. So critical. In a free system, that's so important, because that's how people, particularly young people, start climbing out of poverty. Yes, you first work not getting even paid at first. But that's how you start learning those skills, building that network, building those friendships, building the experience base, and then guess what? You start getting promoted, right? As long as you keep at it, you keep passionate about it, et cetera. So it's very interesting here that this gets us into a discussion about the Chinese Constitution, because the Chinese Constitution, there is no, the governments, of course, it's illegal to set a minimum wage. right? And this is a big point of conversation in the, quote, minimum wage, because you got all these young, brain-dead kids who have been totally brainwashed by the liberal propaganda media and the stupid, you know, what is it, MTV, you know, Viacom-owned big conglomerate, you know, propaganda Illuminati machines that always promote Satanism every time with their artists, bisexualism, transgender, that's the cool thing, and they promote it all the time. Viacom, that's the company that owns MTV, BET, VH1, etc. Know who owns these things. Some old, crinkly, old, crusty man who's bisexual or who has crazy sexual lives is calling the shots on what comes out on those programs, young people. So don't be brain dead. So you have all these people, young kids, who are saying, we got to raise the minimum wage to $20 an hour. How many heard this one? Okay? In California, they're trying, we got to raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour. People got to make a living wage. These big corporations can't even, they're not paying their people a minimum wage or a livable wage. We can't, nobody can survive off of that. You haven't heard this. Did you know which companies support raising the minimum wage? Which are the companies that support raising the minimum wage? You would think that it's like if it's really good for the economy, you would think it's the small business owners or whatever. Guess who lobbies to increase the minimum wage? Big corporations. Walmart, for example, is famous for pumping millions and millions of dollars to raise the minimum wage. Why? Because as you raise the minimum wage, it gets rid of competition. It starts hurting their competition. Because the smaller businesses now have to pay higher prices, and they can't afford those higher prices. So now they can't hire somebody who they would have hired, and that person's economic value would have been added to the labor pool, but now it's not. So the guys who are actually pushing for the minimum wage is big corporations who are, of course, sleeping with the government, having political sex with the government, you know, illicit, you know, political sex with the government. So let's look at the reality of the no-value wages. We have the minimum wage is at $7.25, is that correct? Right, is that correct? $7.25? Is that right? Okay. So the minimum wage currently in the U.S. is $7.25. And of course, we hear that's because the greedy businessmen, they would pay less if they could because they're so greedy. The greedy businessmen are the problem. It's capitalism. It's, you know, it's entrepreneurship. It's small businesses. They're the problem. They're the greedy ones. They're the ones that want to lower the minimum wage. Right? Okay. But what's the reality about the low value of wages? The fact that $7.25, you cannot live off of $7.25, right? It's very hard to live off of $7.25. What's the reality here? Well, the product of these no value wages is a combination of what? It's a combination of terrible government schools that don't train their kids in any economically marketable skills. So none of the kids come out of school, they don't know how to work with electricity, they don't know electrician work, they don't know how to do carpentry, they don't know how to do plumbing, they don't know how to do anything. All they've learned is how to be a brave social justice warrior and go and participate in the slut walk in New York City and say, yay, hoo-hoo, I'm modern. That's all they learned. They learned how to be totally brain dead and idiotic. They learned, of course, socialism and communism, which is packaged into all that feminism, all those teachings, ideologies in high school and college you learn, all of it leads to socialism, communism. Look at the political agendas of those groups. All are leading towards bigger government, more control, using coercion to steal people's taxes and money and use it for themselves. You see that? That is immoral. If you steal, if you're using force to steal somebody's hard-earned labor to do what you want to do with it, is that immoral or is that moral?
Immoral.
That's immoral behavior, right? On any standard. And that's called the principle of the non-initiation of the use of force, okay? So We have terrible government schools who don't teach our kids any marketable skills. They brainwash them into liberal, progressive, fascism, socialism, totalitarianism, that you can use government power and force people to do things for you. Right? Instead of letting people be free and let them use their victories how they want to use them for their interests and their families. What's also the other reality of the minimum wage? The minimum wage actually affects less than 1% of the U.S. population. Did you know that? The minimum wage actually affects less than 1% of the U.S. population, and almost all of that 1% are out of the minimum wage within 1 year. They're almost all cycled out of the minimum wage, making higher wages within 1 year. Isn't that interesting? In 1960, the minimum wage was $1.25. That seems kind of low, doesn't it? Is that lower than $7.25? Okay, well, let's see if you're right. $1.25, that was 5 quarters. If those 5 quarters, if $1.25 kept in pace with the value of silver today, the minimum wage would be more like $26. Did you know that? We'll get into a little more. Government printing money has driven down the value of the currency. By the government constantly making fake money, this has driven down the value of our currency. So even though we have $7.25, we can't buy Shemitah with it. Because they've ruined the currency. Because they're printing so much fake money. Government inflation in the money supply has dropped the value of the wages. And so that's why they're at $7.25. If you get rid of government schools, you privatize those schools and stop governments from printing money, this would immediately solve 80 to 90% of the minimum wage issue. Also, encouraging marriage before having children would solve poverty by 90%, because we see single mother families are predominantly in poverty. It is the highest factor of child poverty. Okay? So, in Chunhyuguk, you see the Constitution does both those things. It gets rid of government schools. Government schools are illegal in Chunhyuguk. They're privatized. They're localized. Okay, so the local people will arm their children to learn skills that are actually economically marketable in the real world. Not some kind of ridiculous, what is it? What do you have? Feminist studies degree, and you can't even be a waitress with that. So empowered, honey. you won't be hired for anything with that, okay? Unless you go to a, you know, socialist, fascist, government-funded institution. Right? So look at the history of government coinage and fraud. Roosevelt first debased the $20 bill, which used to be a certificate for 1 ounce of gold, way back before 1935. How much is an ounce of gold now? $12.90. It's like $1,000 and $1,290. So one $20 bill, you understand that? One $20 bill was a certificate for 1 ounce of gold. That means the $20 bill in modern money, one $20 bill had the purchasing power of $1,290. You see that? It's got so debased because they took out, in 71, Nixon removed every trace of gold from paper dollars. And in 1964, which is a couple years before that, all the silver was removed from all new coinage. Now, this has a very big point. Watch this, folks. The minimum wage was $1 from 1956 to 1960. Oh, that's horrible. That's so bad. 4 silver quarters. Right? Is it really that bad? Hold on. Let's look at this. It was $1.25 from 1963 to 1966. Now, you have to keep an eye. Don't keep an eye on the dollar value. The dollar value don't mean nothing. It's what? It's the metal content in those quarters. Look at those quarters. The minimum wage in the 2 years before 1966, that means 1964 and 1965, was 5.90% silver quarters. You got 5 silver pieces. They call that $1.25, but you got 5 silver pieces. You know, if you play D&D or whatever those you know, medieval games, whatever, you trade in gold pieces and silver pieces, right? Yes. You're not getting, you got, in 1964, you got 5 silver pieces, and they called that $1.25. Okay? If the minimum wage stayed at, so if the minimum wage stays at $1.25, okay, or 5 silver pieces, right? If it stayed at 5 silver pieces and the central bank had not debased the money supply, forcing the reduction or removal of the silver content, minimum wage workers would have been roughly 2 or 3 times better off today. Here's a little picture for you to make it easier to understand. In 1964, the minimum wage was $1.25. Let's say that's 5 silver pieces, right? That's actual silver. If you got quarters from before 1964, that is silver. All right? So you got 5 silver pieces. It looks same as the ones today, the quarters today, but the quarters today, they're not silver. They're cheap, priceless metal. So you don't got no silver pieces anymore. You got cheap, fool's gold metal in your hands. Okay? 5 1964 silver quarters are worth about $20 in 2013. In 2016, it's worth about $26. So I'm going to ask you something. Which one would you rather take? You want to take $15 of minimum wage in fake, priceless, no-value paper money, or you want to take 5 silver pieces, quarters?
5 silver.
Don't be stupid. They have brainwashed the population to be so stupid. They don't understand basic reality. Right? If you have half a brain, you're not going to pay attention to, oh, this is 5 quarters. Forget about that. It's 5 silver pieces. You see what I'm saying? It's 5 silver pieces. You can trade that in for $26. You're getting it. So if you got, if you pay me $1.25 in silver pieces, quarters, that's like $26 an hour. You see? But you have such a brain-dead population. We have these young millennials that will say, oh, no, I still want the $15 an hour of worthless paper, worthless coins. Of course, we don't have those kind of fools here. Okay? This is really what happens. So what's happening is because the government is printing money, because they've removed all the precious metal, and they've defrauded, they've committed fraud against the people by printing fake money. And we're basically giving and buying and selling with fake money, debasing the price of money. Everybody gets hurt. You see what I'm saying? So the problem is not raising the minimum wage. That's exactly what the controllers and elites and these big bankers and the big conglomerates want the kids to focus on. They don't want to focus on the fact that the government is the one who's destroying the money. Yep. Because even if we got paid 5 quarters an hour, that in silver pieces, that would, we would be making double, triple the amount we're making. Do you see what I mean? Yep. Yes. Does that make sense?
Yes.
This is how they fool you. This is why Satan is the king of illusions and the great deceiver. And if people are not able to see through the lies and through the propaganda and through the stupid programming of all the media channels that are owned by 6 conglomerates, 6 crusty old men, many of whom are bisexual and are openly racist, control what you see on TV. Everything you see is owned by them. You understand? So if you're believing what you're seeing on TV and think that's real, you are a fraud. You are a fraud. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
This is reality. Bring back real metal. See, this is why this is a power, folks. this is why we're talking about in our community, learning how to be self-reliant, self-sufficient, producing things, right? And look, as we produce things, we not only can trade by using the current fake fiat, priceless, no value paper money, which can be burned up like that and has zero real value, or we can also trade and, hey, I'd like to buy that head of kale from Greg, and I will trade you a tool that I made on my blacksmithing. You see what I mean? I can trade him something that actually has value, and I can get something in return. I can trade him a silver piece and get something that's worth approximately $26. You see what I'm saying? So as we also, as a community worldwide, start learning interdependence and interdependence and practicing those skills of production and developing those different basic skills, and then on top of those specialized skills, then we'll be able to interact with each other in a different way. You see, we'll be a community of owners, householders, right, that are trading with each other, right? Free association, free trade. And we're not defrauding each other with fake currency. We're giving currency. We're trading for things with things that are valuable, that once you take it from me, I can resell it and I can use it at that stable price. That's why China, for example, does not allow central banks. That's why, of course, every socialist system, communist system, every satanic-based archangelic system all require central banking. Because that's how you control the money supply. And that's how you get everybody fighting with each other instead of focusing on being free and being responsible. That make sense?
Yes.
So that's interesting. That comes right out. So it's interesting how Matthew 20 then gets us into a whole discussion about national currency. Isn't that interesting? How national currency then becomes very important in Chinigong. And what is the currency? Currency not based on a fiat currency. Let's go into the next one that Jesus talks about in Matthew 20. And I use here the Living Bible translation because it's a little easier to understand. And this is from 17. Let's read together. As Jesus went on the way to Jerusalem, he took the 12 disciples aside and talked to them about what would happen to him when they arrived. I will be betrayed to the chief priests and other Jewish leaders, and they will condemn me to die. And they will hand me over to the Roman government. I will be mocked and crucified. And the third day, I will rise to life again. Then the mother of James and John, the sons of Zebedee, brought them to Jesus and respectfully asked a favor. What is your request? He asked. She said, in your kingdom, will you let my two sons sit on two thrones next to yours? But Jesus told her, you don't know what you're asking. Then he turned to James and John and asked them, are you able to drink from the terrible cup that I am about to drink from? Yes, they replied, we are able. You shall indeed drink from it, he told them, but I have no right to say who will sit on the thrones next to mine. Those places are reserved for the persons my father selects. The other 10 disciples were indignant when they heard what James and John had asked for, but Jesus called them together and said, among the heathen, kings are tyrants, and each minor official lords it over those beneath him. But among you, it is quite different. Anyone wanting to be a leader among you must be your servant, and if you want to be right at the top, you must serve like a slave. Your attitude must be like my own, for I, the Messiah, did not come to be served, but to serve and to give my life as a ransom for many. Okay, now, remember, when Jesus is talking about the kingdom, we have to stay at the kingdom level, right? So we're not only interpreting these things on a personal level, individual level. We're talking about it at the kingdom level, the national level. And Jesus, look at this. Here it is, right here in 17, Matthew 20, 17. Jesus was on the way to Jerusalem. He took the 12 disciples aside. Remember how I told you? He didn't preach the crucifixion to the people. He only told in private the disciples. Look, he took the 12 disciples aside and talked to them about what would happen. That he's going to be betrayed, condemned, that he's going to be mocked and crucified. right there for you. Christians are not reading their Bible. They're listening to their denominations. They're not reading their Bible. Jesus took the disciples aside and he told them what would happen. Look at this. Chiefs and priests and other Jewish leaders. Now look at this. Here we are, and here Father has made me his successor. He predicted in 83 that his successor will release the Chinese the constitution, okay, the law of Chinese. And what has happened here, really, the Pharisees are those who are Jews who are pretending to be loyal to Moses and to be loyal to Yahweh, but really they're in bed with money and power. Does that make sense? So, what's happening? They're the ruling class and they're the ruling elites and they're part of the establishment and they will condemn me to die. And we can see this. On the microcosmic level, we see this happening. They're condemning. We will now kill Sanctuary Church. We will kill any of the activities of who? I'm not just one of the sons. I am the inheritor. Do you understand? I am the successor to Father, to Christ. I am the substantial body of true parents that he himself anointed three times on two different continents for everybody to see. I'm not just one of his descendants. I am the line that he chose. And so that property we're talking about, that's our inheritance. That's kingship comes down through there. But the Pharisees who sell out for money and power, for their little paycheck. A lot of these Pharisees, I almost left the church until they came and gave me a six-figure salary. Whoops, I said that? This is how sad these people. Such frauds. And they condemn me to die on the microcosm level. Look at this. They will hand me over to the Roman government. They're taking legal action using the U.S. government to come after me. For what? For telling the truth. For not backing down. For being a real man. Being honorable, having integrity. Living by the samurai code. Right? Not selling out, prostituting yourself for money. And, temporary gain. Not be willing to backstab my father. So use the government and come and mock. Really what they're doing on the microcosm, they're trying to crucify Father's inheritor. Crucify Father's decision. Why? Because Father made the right decision. Because Cain and Abel, who are victorious, we're real men. We don't get bought off by prostitutes for money and power and bribed. We do the right thing because we're normal and because we're good sons. Just like any other normal person would do. But of course, the elites are so decadent that to them, that's so alien. To them, they would so easily prostitute themselves for money and power. So, of course, we are alien, and we need to be what? Mocked, crucified. Now, it's interesting here that Jesus says, and this the woman, the mother of John and James of Zebedee. Remember, they're the fishermen that were fishing with their father, and Jesus said, "Come with me," and they came. And John is the beloved disciple. James is the first to be martyred. So they do drink from the terrible cup that Jesus talks about. They do end up being killed and martyred for Jesus. But the mom comes and asks Jesus, "In your kingdom," now look, Jesus was talking so much about the kingdom that these disciples' mom knew that he was talking about the kingdom and that he was a king. Isn't that interesting? See, we've been so brainwashed. We've not been told that Jesus was constantly talking about the kingdom. He was talking of himself as the king of that kingdom and that he would have a throne in that kingdom. Right? When do you hear this in the Catholic Church? Do you hear this in the Episcopal Church? Do you hear this in the Methodist Church? No. They are not teaching what Jesus was teaching. He was teaching about the kingdom in which he will be king. Right? And so even the mom of these disciples knew that he was talking about these things. And she said, Jesus, can they have a seat? Can they have that seat next to you? And he says, you don't even know what you're asking for. You think, what do you say? Look over here. Among the heathen in the secular satanic world, what do you say? Kings are tyrants. And each minor official lords it over those beneath him. Kings are tyrants, and they create these little vassal kings under them who can rule over their slaves, etc., etc., right? This is the UN system. This is the elitist system. This is the big corporate system. This is the big banker system. This is the same fraud. You understand? It's the same stupid elitism of 2,000, 3,000 years ago. Same ridiculous stuff. Same old, boring. All right, same system. And Jesus says, you don't know what kind of kingdom my kingdom is. You don't know what you're asking me. You think I'm going to be a totalitarian because that's all you know. Your context, your world, all you know is Caesar. That's all you know about a king. But the kingdom that Christ brings is an upside down kingdom. It's opposite way around kingdom. It's top go down kingdom. Does that rhyme? Is that all rhyme? Okay. And he says, you don't know what you are asking. Your assumption is that it will be a kingdom in the satanic model. It will be quite different. He said, I have no right because who will sit on the thrones is my father's decision. This is what's amazing. In the Chinese constitution, when the nation is established, and it will be because it's already been released, it will be established in the real world. And when it is established, even though we are not present, or if we are, then we'll see it. But when it is, under the king's authority is the right to determine who the Supreme Court judges were. Remember we talked about last week with the 12 judges? That Jesus says that he will make them 12 judges that will judge the people of Israel. Okay? And it's interesting here because he says, I have no right to say who those judges will be. He says, my father will select it. Does this make sense? He says his father will select it. So when the kingdom comes, the father will select those judges. And this is what we have to understand about substantial body and why in Chinigu there is a kingship that Christ himself established, right? Yes. Christ came in the flesh and in the time of Jesus, but because he was killed and did not leave the bloodline of Christ, the kingdom in the physical world could not be established, right? It could not be a kingdom of everlasting where Christ is a center and rules for the millennial reign and eternity. But so thus Christ need to come back. But when Christ came back and Father, as Christ came back to restore the three criteria that the Bible says must be established by Christ, which is what? Bridegroom, judge of evil, and king. Through the blessing, Father established the bridegroom, the brides of Christ, through the judging of, look at this, political as well. He did political judging too. He judged communism worldwide as Satan's system, socialism as Satan's system, totalitarianism as Satan's system. He judged evil. Wasn't it weird that Father was a religious leader, but he was doing politics, political stuff? Wasn't that weird? And then he was also doing business and stuff like that, where he was doing businesses. Everybody's saying, oh, you know, why do they, you know, Dalai Lama don't do businesses and Dalai Lama don't do this and that. No, Father, I'm sorry, the Dalai Lama does do lots of politics for the liberal progressive side, unfortunately. But Father was involved. Christ was involved in politics, business, economics, religion, it all. He was involved in it all, right? And in those things, he established the attack against Satan's system, attack against the political system of Satan. That was the entire VOC movie movement worldwide, ending communism worldwide, end Marxism worldwide, etc. And then, of course, Father established after 2001 the crowning ceremonies and then the establishment of God's kingship, the coronation of God's kingship, and then the establishment of the physical kingship. So I had a conversation with my kids in Hundoke, and we were talking. I was talking to Shinjun, who Father chose as the third king. And I said to him, don't think being the king is where you get to, you know, where the white, what is that, white little thing with the fur and that has those black dots on it, the crazy, what is that thing? What do you call that thing? Ermine? Ermine? I don't know. Okay, well, anyways, you wear the thing. Oh, yes. I'll trot down here. Everybody, don't be delusional, you bum. Right? So you got to, I said, child, you have to let the King of Kings use your body. So the kingship of God is where the kings have to get rid of themselves, their own desires. They have to let the Holy Spirit of true Father reside in them and live through their body. So I told my kids, I don't personally like fishing so much, but because Father loved fishing, I have to go fishing for him. I don't like fishing, honestly. It's kind of, you know, slimy and sick, and I like bushcrafting, I like making fires, you know, and all that kind of thing. I don't personally like fishing so much. But I told my son, especially him, I said, and Appa will take you, Daddy will take you especially to do that kind of training, because that's part of our tradition and culture of Chonigu. And you have to maintain that outdoorsman, that wild man spirit, that unabashed masculinity and subjectivity. You have to embrace your masculinity and your dominion over creation, and you have to be able to love the outdoors. That's part of our tradition that Wangappa gave to us. Right, so we have a nice game now in our house where if they go to lake and catch a bass, they get 1 hour of game time. Woo! If they catch bluegills, that's 10 minutes. So they have to catch 6 bluegill to get an hour. But they can't only catch it. They also have to gut it. They have to cook it and then feed it to their daddy as an offering for medicine. Then I give them the internet password. It's so important to pass down the traditions. So important to pass down the tradition. And in the same way, when I was talking to my son, I said, look, you have to remember what Jesus said. He said, in the secular world, the Satan's kingdoms, the kings are tyrants and each minor official lords over those beneath him. You see him in the kingdoms of the past, the kingdoms and the lords. Everybody was trying to be a lord under the king, right? Because then you can take control over one little area and you can have your little fiefdom and you can be a little lord over there and you can basically rape all the women. And in England, what do? They, Scotland or Ireland, one of them. The king would come in and sleep with every woman before they got married. Did you hear about this one? This is real. Was Scotland? Okay. This was in the movie Braveheart too, right? But that's based on a historical fact. So the kings are tyrants, each minor official lords it over, and these are not only Christian cultures, of course, Islamic culture. Brutal, 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 brutal. Right? We even did a study on slave trade in Islamic tradition, right? So I'm not just going after the corrupt kings of Christianity or those in the Christian culture. No, the Islamic caliphate was brutal. Brutal. Right? So and Jesus says these satanic kings are tyrants, each minor official lords it over those beneath them. Chinese emperors, Korean emperors, Japanese emperors, you name it, African emperors, Russian emperors, you name it, they're all the same. They're all the same. They're in the same camp. They're led by the same spirit, the spirit of hell. And they create centralized governments to destroy and to exploit their population. But among you, it will be different. He said to them, anyone wanting to be a leader amongst you must be the servant, must be your servant. And look at this. If you want to be at the top, you must serve like a slave. You must be a slave. Isn't that interesting? So I also, my boys are very mature. I'm very grateful. You know, the older kids are much more mature, and they have such an amazing example. I always tell them, look, Appa didn't choose your younger brother to be in the kingship line. Okay? That's not, I did not choose that. That was Father chose that. Your job is to protect him. Right? And your guy's job is easy because you have an example. And I asked him, did Uncle Kukjin Samchun try to kill your daddy? Right? When Father gave him the kingship, did he burn with anger and say, I want to kill that little Shmita? Right? Some of the other ones did, but he didn't. He was totally different. He said, in his heart, he said, long live the king. And later on, he said, this is my king. And I said to my boys, you guys are older than him. You don't even have to worry about this emotionally, psychologically. You have the example. You just have to protect him because one day he will be your king. And that's not a big deal. He's not going to rule over you like a tyrant. He has holding the kingship. You protect him as your king. You see that? And then, of course, when I talk to the third king, I say, and what is it? You want to be a top? You have to be a slave. You don't have your, you have to lose yourself. You lose yourself. You have to live, number one, to protect the Constitution. You don't live to try to aggregate power to yourself and monopolize power. You live to protect the Chunyugu Constitution because that is the covenant given from God to the people of owners of Chunyugu. Your job is to be a slave to the Constitution of Chunyugu. You protect it with your life. That is the center of the nation. Your attitude must be like my own, for I, the Messiah, did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give my life as a ransom for many. We have to understand. Look, in Chunyuguk, you have politicians, etc. You have the Supreme Court judges, all these people. These people are part of the government. Some are hereditary, some are elected. So you have two conflicting systems. You have an elected group of, you know, president, House of Representatives, senators, etc. And then you have hereditary. And these two are inherently conflicting, which is good because it balances power. One is political by election, one is non-political by bloodline, which again creates the tension which allows the governments to separate powers and to keep powers away from each other. Does that make sense? Balance out the powers, not let them be congregated under one. Does that make sense? So for I, like the Messiah, Jesus said, did not come to be served, but to serve and to give my life as a ransom for many. This is the Isaac generation. This is the Isaac generation. With the failure of the Han mother offering herself as a dove of Abraham, the final offering, if she just said, praise be to God, and all the brothers and sisters of the world pray to your heavenly Father and ask Father to be alive and powerful in your life. Move with the power of the Holy Spirit. Be anointed, be blessed, and let us change this world. Let us glorify his name and lift him. If she did that, and of course, if she then did what my wife was, which is to bow to Father's blood lineage, because she came from satanic bloodline, just like every first generation, principle 101, standard principle, everybody knows it. If she bowed to Father's blood lineage and his kingship, the king's bloodline, she would have set the precedent for Satan to have to surrender to the lineage of God. She would, he has to, because his own child has completely surrendered herself to the Messiah's blood lineage and the bloodline. Come under the authority completely, not left the object position to try to usurp the position of subject, and of course bring destruction upon her own head and the heads of many. Right? But we know because of that failure, Then the provenance moves to three generations. And this is the Isaac generation. The Isaac generation is the generation where we go onto the altar, folks. We go onto the altar as a ransom for many. The sacrifice and the persecution, the mockery that we receive is not for our glory. Amen?
Amen.
We are not standing here to be some kind of internet superheroes and pretend that we're being mocked and we're tough. We are fighting for our lives and for our descendants and our future and the future destiny of God's kingdom is what we're fighting for. We're fighting for the future of humanity, the future of the kingdom of God, the future of freedom and prosperity and liberty and responsibility. Right? We're fighting for something way bigger than personal glory. And that's what Jesus says. You got to have my attitude. You got to have this attitude. Don't come to be served, become serve, and to give your life as a ransom for many. Think about it. In that sense, I guess we are selfish. We want our children not to live in an anti-human, anti-freedom, anti-responsibility, controlled, superficial, totalitarian state. I guess we're selfish, you could say that. Or I guess you could say we believe in the great hope and promise that God has given us from the beginning of time. Yes. To the elites, we are hopeless, we are debased, we are troublemakers, we are rebellious, we are anti-human, yes. But we are anti-Satanist. We're anti-Satan, we're anti-Luciferian. Yes. We're against their control. Yes. And because we may be weak and because we may be have nothing, and but all we have is to be mocked and persecuted and jested at and be poked at and made fun of, we have nothing to lose and everything to gain. Now, the elites are so arrogant that they always underestimate how powerful people who have a true purpose can be. We are the Isaac generation, folks. The sacrifice that we make today has repercussions for our descendants, our children, and the nation they will live in. Let's finish up with 16:16, Chun Sung Young. Let's read together. By inheriting the tradition through becoming one with true parents, true father, subject, your family becomes the foundation that can govern all nations. With the subject tradition. And acquires the attributes of a subject partner. As such, your family will enter the realm of the royal family in God's kingdom. What is a citizen in God's kingdom? It's a king. Royal family in God's kingdom. This pattern forms the basis upon which all nations can be governed with the tradition of the subject partner. And the constitution of Chunilguk, which protects the covenant between God and his people. The love of God the Father. The love of God as the subject for his people, his children, his bride, his love. Amen. Let's all rise, everybody. SOS, come on up. And even though we are in the valley, it's so important. Yes, Lord's Valley and many other valleys, ups and downs. Many people are struggling through many things. Many people being attacked at different levels. Because as the battle ensues, Satan's resistance ensues, right? So it's something we have to expect and know that is coming. Go ahead, guys. Okay. So as we praise God and lift him up, go ahead. You can start. Go ahead. You can start. Imob, we can start. And as we worship God, praise God, let's think about that. What is the sacrifice we're making today? Is that for us? No, it's for the future. It's for the future kingdom of God's heaven on earth. Amen. Let's praise God.
Everyone needs forgiveness. A kindness of a savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered. Conquer the grave. Take me as you find me, all my fears and failures.
Your ways are always better. Your plan is always good. So let us trust in you, Lord. Let us follow you.
Letting go of every single day. I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I've tried to win this war, I confess. My head's all weary, I need your rest. Mighty warrior, king of the fight, no matter what I face, you're by my side. When you walk through, when you don't give the answers, as I cry out to you, I will trust in you. Truth is, you know what tomorrow brings. There's not a day ahead you had not seen. So in all things, be my life and bread. I want what you want, Lord, and You are my strength and comfort. You are my steady hand. You are my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. Your ways are always higher. Your plans are always good. There's not a place where I go you're not already stood. When you don't move the mountains, I needed you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't see the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. Trust in you. I will trust in you. I will trust in you.
Thank you, Father, for all you've given us, for all your glory. We want to lift you up today. We love you, Father. This is for you. Please take our praise.
My Savior, Redeemer, lifted me from the miry clay.
For your love. We want to feel your presence today, Father. Not just in bad times, also in the good ones. We love you. Let's celebrate all together. Let's lift him up today.
Chonin Chaman Samde Wang Kwan, Ang Manse, Chani Guk Changa, Ang Manse, Aju, hug your neighbor. God's kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Okay, praise artists, please peek painting.